And so what I have, and I'm going to let you guys kind of drive how much or little you want. As I have, we just yesterday did the budget framework to the board, and we intentionally right now do the budget in two parts. I do a framework and a staffing plan early in March, so March 8th, so we can punch go on staffing on March 9th, which lets us be out early because our issue for years has been way late because we have such a convoluted process. So we both streamlined the process and split the budget in two parts so that we can go early. So as of yesterday morning, we met with all the principals and gave them their staffing information. And then we punch go this morning after I presented to the board, we punch go on staffing and that process starts. And then I make visible, here are all the things I'm thinking about for the budget as a whole, but we call it the framework rather than a proposal, because by the time I present it to the board, which will be March 29th, then it becomes the proposal. So I still have time to listen and tinker here between the time I first make it visible and when I present it to the board. Okay, so we're still a little bit in motion. So what I'm gonna do is take you through, and I'm gonna do, this document is online, so I'm more gonna take you through the thread of it and then pause on pages I really wanna talk about. But I'm going to say, so you get a train of thought in here, but if you want to really read it, you're going to have to go online and go read it, because otherwise it'll take us way too long to get through. Does that feel okay to you? Did anybody already see this? Okay, so some people have already.
David.
Including David. It's a good thing. Okay, so the process, we're right there. The framework went to the board, and school staffing has started, and then it just takes you all the way through the town halls and the other opportunities. You guys are my one listening session. So just to say, this is my one listening session. Otherwise, I've met with a bunch of people to kind of hear, but we're in the second year of a biennium, so there's not a ton more to work with. The framework, and this one, you just, like, it's all our strategic, our vision, our mission, every student by name, prepare for college career, community participation. Our strategic framework for the entire district, which is our value values, our core commitments, and our foundational elements. What we ask the best practices for every individual school, so kind of a different level of what do we want in place at every school for every school to be successful. Then our milestones for every student, which are key transition points, and this is more high level as a system, what are we looking for, and we're looking at the success as kids are at those key transition points. And then we have seven priorities that myself and the board have worked to, that have just been approved by this new board, that are major budget drivers. So strong principal and vice principal in every building, equal match to the school community, environment in which sports are a place for teachers to thrive and have a voice in district decision making, each student prepared for life, college, and career, and to meaningfully contribute in their communities. Literacy as a core, and we're doing this K-12, but it's really the fundamental if you don't have that together, and third grade is one of our measure moments that we think makes the difference in terms of your, as a student, your ability to take advantage of every other opportunity while you're in school. The behavior supports that reduce our disproportionality in suspension and expulsion, and we've been really working overall on reducing exclusionary disciplinary practices and increasing teachers' ability to support kids taking responsibility for their behavior and stay in school. So this is a big one. The bond, continuing tracking on time on budget, and the enrollment balancing process. So those are our seven big priorities. We're then applying the equity lens, which is basically by any decision, who's impacted and what are you doing to mitigate or remove barriers. And then budget principles that were developed by our community budget review committee that are really good. What are the drivers that should be driving budget decisions? Context, we're in the second year of the biennium, which means we both know the revenue that we're working with. We're not in a wait and see game with the legislature. But we also know we don't have more to work with than we had last year. We have our contract expiring with PAT. We've made significant investments in the last couple of years. However, we also have huge pent-up demand, which you know. So we've got a huge amount of what are people ready to do and excited to do that we don't have the resources to do. So we have increasing enrollment. So again, we're like
years into an increasing enrollment pattern, after a long period of declining enrollment, and we're looking at 5,000 students over the next decade, so managing growth is a really different thing than we were trying to shrink our footprint and save core programming. So we're just in a very different world. That's a great world to be in, but has its challenges too. And then implementation of the grade reconfiguration is a one that's evolving at the same time we're doing this. So here's our 96 to 2007 downward trend. Now we're on our upward trend enrollment-wise, and then these are our projections in the go-forward. So you just get we're in a, and you can feel it. I mean, you feel it in the city. You can see it in the density of what's kind of popping up around us, and all of these, we need schools. So it's a good challenge to have. Okay, other steady increase in our graduation rates, which we're excited about. We've been on a really good steady upward trend here. And both our four-year graduation completion and five-year completion. So again, time is a variable for some kids, and we want to be able to stick with them until they are, complete and stepped over to whatever they do next. The race and ethnicity up for every racial and ethnic group, but we still have gaps that we're working to close. We've now just gotten to the same graduation rate as the whole state of Oregon, so this is a big milestone getting where we started. So you guys, this is one where I just will be like, okay, not where we want to be, and we've come a long way from where we were not that long ago here.
Well, in spite of the budget.
In spite of, during the biggest recession in forever.
Bravo.
We made great, and it was a great moment that we were just like, we just got to this state. And then also our gap is closing. So you had a 2009, we had a 19 percentage point difference between our historically underserved and not historically underserved. It's now a 13 point difference, but that's a significant reduction, and we want to accelerate that so that we cannot determine by race what student achievement is. So that's our huge goal, and it's a huge driver in the budget. So this is one that I just say, you see progress, but you get why it's still a driver for us. Saying we've reduced our exclusionary discipline practices significantly, and we still have disproportionality. And here's where you get to see, again, where we have 13, 14, here's 14, 15, so big difference. However, still great disproportionality, so you get why this is still a driver. So this is where, again, we're on the right track, we're making gains, and we are still working hard to impact this differential. Okay, our framework. Looking at current level of service and sustaining that to students, families, and schools, sustaining and building upon the priorities that I just showed you, and sustaining our organizational capacity to support schools. Our assumptions, and I'm going to buzz through this one because this is all, what are the things like underlying the budget and what's in the forecast. We did, this one I'm going to say out loud, because last year the state, in order to feel like we had more money in the first year of the biennium, asked us to budget 50-50 as opposed to 49% in the first year and 51% in the second year, so you can sustain levels of service. We were like, okay, no, then we have to cut next year. They added a little bit more into the budget. Subsequently, we banked the amount that would allow us to do 49-51 in our budget so we could sustain levels of service. So it's an important action that allowed us to be able to do what we're doing this year. So our assessed value at 4%, compression, negative 3.5 percentage points. Our enrollment, here's just our, so these are the historic patterns of what lets us make our assumptions that we're making in constructing the budget. The expenditures, so the puts and takes of one-time items that we extract or things that we're continuing on into the next year with an amendment. We do an overall 3% increase, and then we get specific about which things really take the increase or not. And adding teachers for the 650 students. So that all goes into our initial budget assumption. And then our unassigned contingency or our reserves. Last year it was, in our proposed budget, it was 2.6. In our amended budget, it was 2.3. We're increasing it to 2.4. We actually have a policy that requires us to be at 3 percentage points. We're below our policy, but we're increasing it. And we have been aspiring to get to 5%. Clearly, we're not there, but we're investing and working slowly to increase the reserve.
And does that include the planning that was done around PERS or?
The side account, I mean, actually, you know what, here's what I'm going to do, I'm going to go right to the PERS thing right there.
Okay, yeah, thanks.
David, do you want to talk a little bit about PERS?
Sure, it doesn't include the, we do have a separate side reserve for PERS because we know that not next year, but the year after, PERS rates are going to accelerate dramatically because of all the changes in the system.
Okay, funds available to invest, roughly $6.5 million. And all the ways that we calculated it. So again, if you're looking for more detail on reading any of these slides, go find it online and go through and read it, or ask me to back up and we can talk more about any of the slides you want more chat about. But.
And if you need to find it online, it's in two places. It's in the board materials for last night's board meeting. It's also on the budget department webpage.
And am I going too slow for you, or is this, are you wanting what I'm telling you? Just check, you know, am I boring you, or do you want this information? Okay, so next year's budget, $570 million in the general fund, so that's really what we're talking about. And the school staffing that we just did. Again, prioritizing sustaining staffing from the first year of the biennium. We added a bunch of school-based staff last year, and our goal was sustain the people we just hired, hang on to them, and provide time for strategies to take hold, and continue to be willing to differentiate based on what kids need and what schools need. So that was something we made a commitment to, and we're continuing to be willing to do that. Not just everybody gets a formula, but go beyond formula, so, and maintaining our equity formula. Providing the non-formula additions that let us recognize differences in what a school may need or unusual circumstances. Ensuring access to the core program, so you get to come back and ask for things as a school after you get your formula that says I can't get to core program, you know, either help me get there or I need additional staff in order to be able to offer it. And that's the priority. And then we maintain a set aside pool in order to bolster school's ability to do that. Our formula, so we start with the ratio that's purely by size, then we do the equity formula, which I'll tell you about on the next page. Then we have our school-wide support table, which essentially, here's the core staff, like principal, your vice principal, your secretary, librarian, counselor, all shows up in a school-wide support table. So there's some amount of size variability that doesn't impact the school support table. However, you hit thresholds where you pop up and get a different level of support. So it's got its own trajectory of thresholds of growth that then kick you into getting an AP or two VPs or so, but it's a core that other increases or decreases in students don't impact it. We know you need this to run a school. And then finally, the non-formula FTE, you come back and ask for those and we give you those, and then you get your total FTE to work with. The equity formula is essentially, it's based on your direct certification of meals, so your SES, plus a 4% that is based on combined underserved, which is about the four historically underserved racial groups, special ed, ELL, and SES combined. So it's an 8% set aside that then gets reallocated based on your individual school's reflection of these populations. You get the equity allocation ranges from 0.5 to 8 and impacts 55 schools, including all the high schools. And the idea here is that you are targeting support services to your historically underserved students that are above and beyond what everybody gets. So that's what the intent is here. Last year, the equity was rolled into people's overall FTE allocation. This year, it's going to be called out separately, and schools will be asked, what are you using it for at the front end, rather than reporting at the back end, because we're really trying to figure out tracking, is this make a difference or not? And for years, it was just helping you not cut as much, right? So it basically let you survive and have less cut. So you had more adults in the building than schools that were getting more severe cuts. It helped you fill potholes. We're now hitting a threshold that this should let schools do additional supports. So we're trying to really track that. Non-formula, which schools get, and I'm going to tell you this one because you could hear from your principals, we're losing all the whatever we're losing. And we back out whatever non-formula ad somebody got last year. a school got last year gets backed out at the beginning of this year, you get your formulas, then you have to come back and say, I still have that same circumstance. This is the, you know, this is the need the school has. So it gets re-established every year what the non-formulas are. Okay, so first goal of this year was sustaining staff we added last year. So I wanted to make visible to the board, here's what we did last year. We added EA support in kindergarten. We added literacy coaches, career and college readiness staffing. So middle grades, we did art, music, and AVID. High school, we did college and career readiness and AVID. We added 20 high school teachers. We added counselors at elementary and K-8s and middle schools. This is a significant, for us, like for the decades of nothing, this was such a significant boost of school-based staff. It was really exciting. So I probably just wanted to relive it again.
We appreciate it.
Well, I'm going to tell you, having a new board who wasn't around to do this, I need them to see, here's what we did last year, and we are sustaining this, so.
The RTACS is part of that.
It's separate. Yeah, that was
okay. There we go. Thank you.
Yeah, it's on top of that. And the RTACS is another one that we do a separate column, so school sees exactly what they're getting.
Right.
And we also did rounding to 0.25 or 0.5.
On the equity allocation, we rounded it up and down to 0.25.
And arts, we did to 0.5.
Great.
So
thanks.
You don't get fractional people.
Yep.
That you end up with enough to, well, this is so huge. I mean, you guys, these are like things that seem so like like geeky, and they're not. They make a difference in terms of what you get to do in your school. So
we had a big debate with the arts tax about whether or not to round it to 0.2, so that would be days of the week, and everybody said just
Okay, so we also added school secretaries, EAs, and paraprofessionals. We did library media specialists in our K-5, K-8 middle schools. We added so the school-wide support table I was describing, we added a new threshold that if you're above 1,600 in the high school, you get a new VP. And we added an additional administrator in schools that were that have a bond, so they're under construction, where you want the principal to be able to do instructional leadership, but they're also managing this huge construction and tours and all. I mean, there's a whole thing that comes with having a bond that draws away from your principals if that's what they're doing. So we are trying to honor that. We increased our high school athletic directors to full time, and we added a middle school athletic director, which we're trying to build programming down into the middle grade. This was cool. I'm just going to say this was a good thing. So we're trying to sustain all that. Proposed staffing plan, we added staff for the projected 650 additional kids, and we're holding our staffing ratio steady. And we increased that set aside from 50 held back to 60 held back so that we can then do ads where people need them. And we added compacted math to the list of core program because we heard from some schools that had small numbers of kids who didn't get it. And so some of those strategies may be itinerant staff to offer it, but how do we have it available to every kid? So and that comes in there's like and I think we put this online too, the staffing document that's the guidance for principals as they're staffing, identifies the core program, tells them here's the guidelines for what you need to make sure you have as you're staffing, and then you have discretion as you've done all the things that we're saying every school needs to do. So important note, when I'm representing trying to hold all these staff that we hired, it's as an entire district. The variability still happens at the school level if you lose, you know, ebb and flow with kids. So some will get more, some will get less. You will still see it reflected if you have fewer kids coming to your school next year, which is just the difference between when you do a system level stability message and a school level, you may not experience that because you have fewer kids. So just being very clear about that it's a caution in how you hear what I'm saying. So the lower staffing in an individual school, you could have projected student enrollment decline. You could see it because we've pulled out your non-formula FTE that you have to ask for again. And this is also a function of projection. So if your PSU projection last year had you higher than who actually showed up, we didn't come back and take that staff away from you. We left it in place. And then this year, at the revised projection, you may end up experiencing a drop because we didn't come back. Once we've done it, we try not to go disrupt once the school year is underway, because you've done, you know, people have staffed. So just to say, these could be factors why staff would go down. ELL, we're down 202 kids, and it took the staffing to schools down by 7.5 FTE. However, we didn't take that staff away from ELL, so even though we're down, here's how that staff is redeployed. 3 FTE end up being balancing FTE that schools could come ask for based on their circumstances. 1.5 end up being coaching capacity for schools with less than 10 kids. And then 2 floaters to cover the ELL vacancies, and 1 assessment specialist who was evidently last year on a temporary contract, but we need them to be an employee. So the capacity is still there, even though we've gone down for kids. We're trying to hold the capacity. Special ed students are up by 123 kids. Our learning center teacher allocations ended up going down by 1, but it's held in as the balancing FTE, so it'll get redeployed, so it'll end up being even. But we've then added 2 speech pathologists and 2 occupational therapists, because that's where we were feeling the need in the special ed staffing world. And then the other thing we've added is 2 K-2 pre-inclusion classrooms that are where we've been really working on inclusion, an inclusion model, and heard back from teachers pretty loud and clear a non-readiness to be fully there, and a need for having classrooms that are still able to serve K-2 kids that are not ready to be fully in inclusion. So we've done this right now to respect what we're hearing, but also with the idea that we're trying to have the capacity to have kids be in full inclusion model. So this is not a direction we're headed. It is a recognition of just where are we as a system and then our ability to support full inclusion and have teachers feel ready with other ideas of how you support kids being in a classroom. So, but that's a big add. That's like 8 staff to do the 2 classrooms. Title I, our district allocation went down by $735,000, but we're maintaining our student per student allocation to schools, which is still 658 students. And we have 5 schools that fall below the eligibility threshold year that we are bridging this year. And David gave a good explanation last night that was really if you are just dropping under frequently, a lot of school that pops back in, so trying to hold steady.
We need those schools?
Do you know what schools are?
I do know what schools are. The schools are Jefferson, Roosevelt, Alliance, Peninsula, and a 5th one that I don't remember.
That's pretty good.
And Jefferson, for instance, last year we were able to pay for the SEI wraparound services for part of that out of their Title I budget. We're now moving that over into general fund, but we're bridging the rest of the per student Title I still with Title I. So there's kind of a, you know, how do we bridge? Part 2. So the budget framework, and now this is the part that's beyond school staffing that actually comes back as a proposal on the 29th. And it really is 2 big investments, one of which is K-12 literacy and the other is the enrollment balancing. So in terms of big price tags, that's what the big price tags. Yeah, David?
Creston.
Thank you. Strong principle, there are the metrics, you go read them online. The investments from the first year and the big investment this year is really we're repurposing money internally to mentor new principals. But it's not a budget ask, it's looking for the mentoring capacity and what we already have and making sure we're supporting new principals. Environment supports for teachers, the metrics. Sustaining our workload committee from year 1, which was a PAT, PPS committee to be able to address workload issues as they occur and be able to be more responsive, like holding back money that we can say you've got this wildly big class and here you need an EA, and they get to come up with what the solutions are as that committee, and we've got money reserved for them to have come up with solutions. And we expanded our new teacher mentor program last year significantly with general fund, Miller Foundation and Nike School Innovation Fund. We're maintaining that wildly successful, both for the mentors and the new teachers. It's been really good. So holding on to that, and then just substitute coverage for teachers to participate in major decision-making processes. And the main investment, small, but it's we're doing interest-based bargaining with PAT, which is more of a joint problem-solving method. that this is the facilitation, so. This one, the college and career, a number of investments last year that I'm not going to belabor, metrics, last year's investment. So pretty long list, some of which we're pulling over to the general fund, things that have been supported by grants. And again, go spin through that one if you want to online. The this year ones are having our Office of Teaching and Learning do the alignment across the AP and IB classes, in particular, across the system to try and get some calibration of what we're offering in different schools, and then doing curriculum purchasing that supports those classes. Hey, Paul. Thank you for being here. A CTE business partnership manager. We've just gone from, in the last 2 years, from 19 CTE programs of study to more than 50. And this person would be a central person to help build the business relationships. So adding that capacity to support continuing to build our CTE capacity. Summer school for high school kids. Maintaining SEI as the whole school model, like I just described. So this is it's SEI, PCC, and Jefferson. And our graduation rate was 80 percentage points this year at Jefferson! We've got something that is working and has been on a steady trajectory, so sustaining the support even as we are shifting what we're using to fund it. The high school graduation initiative coordinator, ending a grant, so again, moving it to general fund. Advanced scholars, which has been huge support in our high schools to have underserved students be accessing AP classes in particular. And it's really changing cultures of high schools. So Franklin, Madison, and Roosevelt all have this. This lets us start to build it at Graham. College Possible we have at Madison. This lets us at Franklin. It's coming out of Gear Up Fund. And then finally, a social studies engagement teacher on special assignment to help build our social studies capacity. And that one is redirecting existing resources. So literacy, there's our metrics. What we did last year, which included full day K and EAs in kindergarten. This is one of the big investments, and it's only phase one of the big investment. So we're implementing the 6-12 literacy adoption this year, and in phase one of the pre-K-5 literacy adoption. That price tag that right here is $2.1 million for phase one is really a $7.5 million price tag. So to do the whole district, this ends up letting us do 10 schools in depth. 5 of them end up with more support from Mount Hood Cable Regulatory Commission that lets us do some blended learning and technology, that they're going to get more intensive stuff because of the grant. And then it's a cohort of demonstration classrooms that let us go broad so that we're piloting across the district in a way that other teachers can go observe. So it's the first, and it's material. So it's the first phase of the work. And then K-3, some summer literacy programs for K-3. There's the big price tag that I just wanted to bookmark it in there, that it's the whole thing and we're only doing a beginning portion of it. Priority 5, the behavior supports and reducing suspensions, expulsions, the metrics. Last year we added school climatosis and the capacity to do training and support in restorative justice, positive behavior intervention and support. And our culturally responsive instruction, so that we're sustaining our ability to do that in this year. We've added a coordinator for a crisis response team, and this is coming out of our interest-based bargaining with PAT. That's really a new person who can rally the appropriate people within the district to go respond to a particular crisis situation. So it's somebody who can rally the particular troops that we need to go be responsive, as it's needed.
Carol?
Yeah.
Oh, Franklin PTA is having their meeting tonight. Their topic is restorative justice.
Oh, good.
And so, Portland Council had a meeting about that last March. So, do you know which schools, I'm assuming it started at Franklin this year, or possibly last year. Do you know what schools are using that? Probably don't.
Well, you know what, we have a lot of different levels of restorative justice support, because we've started this. Some have had full-time people who are grant supported, who, like, you have restorative justice staff. Others are doing restorative practices that are much more training existing staff in restorative practice. I can't name you, like, where, who's got what level of depth. This is trying to build restorative practice across the whole district. Like, Grant was doing, had a part-time person who was helping to do build the culture at Grant. I know we've had, like, different schools that have had a full-time person, and then when the grant funding goes away, either you've built the culture in the school or you haven't. We're trying to do the how do we train people and build culture in restorative practice that we can sustain. So, and I don't know, do you know any, David, or can you name a more specific school?
I know we've got things at Riglaw, I know we've got things at Grant, I know we've got things at George, but that's just happenstance that I know those schools. And it's like you said, in some places you've got committed staff where it's well established, but the idea is to really build the idea of what restorative practices are, so that it's not, you don't have to have a special person. It's something that a whole bunch of people know how to do.
And the idea with this one is that you're really working with kids to take responsibility for their behavior and restore harm in a relationship. So some of this is just an approach of how you frame resolution to a conflict that isn't, okay, I send you away, but how do I help you get the support you need to repair the harm that's been done? So, like, that's the, in essence, what it is. It's a framework. It's a framework that lets me, actually, Kevin Bacon does some good stuff about how they're using it. Like, there are a bunch of places, but at varying degrees, and this is, the TOSA support is how are we giving support to schools to build it into their own culture.
Okay, and it's also a central resource, so if you have a major incident,
people will come.
You've got people who can come and actually sort of help you. So if there's a big thing happen,
they'll come facilitate, they'll come support you. Yeah, thank you for having that.
So one thing we did hear, we've heard from a couple schools anecdotally, is the staff gets trained up, then there's a turnover because you know, some of those schools are the schools that have a lot of younger teachers, and then the teachers launch, and they take the memory of that training with them. I don't know, I mean, I plant that seed with you, and I suspect you've heard the same.
You know this too.
Yeah.
And actually, one of our conversations with PAT has been about our school climate plan, that every school is supposed to have a school climate plan, and they're all, again, this is one that's variable across the district as well, but really should end up saying, here's what we're doing in the school, here's how we're bringing everybody on board and training and understanding the training needs. And our goal was to have everybody have a climate plan in place by the end of the school year that is able to drive preparation for next year.
How do the parents plug into that?
It's a great question.
Okay.
Well, because I think it's at a school level. I mean, I think this is a conversation with your principal about what's our school climate plan, how can we be involved?
Okay.
I mean, I just think it's a pretty direct conversation, and what do you need from us in terms of, like, how we're shaping school culture in the school?
That sounds like a newsletter thing that Lisa and I will conspire about, and maybe somebody from
And consult your principal about, okay, how do I frame this? Like, I think this is a really direct consultation with your principal of how do we play a supportive role as we're trying to build positive school cultures. And what do you need most from parents? Like, it's the place to be in high collaboration. So,
Carol, I participated in two site councils, and both of them have had those type of discussions.
Have they?
So, yes, right.
Good. And I'm thinking there. Like, again, I know this is variable across the district, but I think it can be inspired by you asking the question.
Sure.
Okay, on time, on budget with the bond. This one's mostly paid for by the bond, so the little bit of general fund. We did MDIP, Minority Women and Emerging Small Business Tracking Software, that is part of our equity and public purchasing and contracting goals for the bond of how we're spending our money. So we did the tracking software that came out of general fund last year, and then we're gonna do a report, third party doing a report on how people feel our participation was in the design advisor groups and the master planning groups. We did that for the first schools that went through the bond, and we'll continue to do that just so that we're getting feedback. Enrollment balancing. So this is another one of the big price tags. So the first one there, the grade reconfiguration. This includes the planning process I talked about for conversion to middle schools, a district-wide planning group, as well as You see the two principals to plan for engage for the opening of two schools to start up in 2015. We want to hire the two future middle school principals to be part of this first year of planning, and that they get to both do the central planning and the work with their communities. So hopefully this is a template for how we are trying to do this in a thoughtful way. The $1.5 million is also a placeholder because we're still in the deciding process around what we're doing and what's the sequence and the speed at which we do it. If, in fact, we open a middle school in 2016, this helps as the placeholder to be able to do what we need to do that. It's also, if it lands that we move a focus option in the fall, then it helps us do that. So it's basically bookmarking. Those will be expensive things to do, and there's the money for us to do it. Facility upgrades for East Sylvan and three middle school buildings. The conversation with the board is proposing that we actually take a loan to do these. It's a combination of a loan and put it in future bonds, but the loan would be paid back with our construction excise tax. So leverage the dollars we have in the construction excise tax to borrow enough money to prepare the facilities to do this conversion. And then the last one is the transportation portion of increasing instructional time for the K-8 middle grades kids to match what the middle school kids get. So it's a 15-minute differential. And there is more complexity than just transportation. There's supervision, there's workload. So there's a bunch of stuff in there that the thing I can name and bookmark a hold on it is, here's what it would take for us to do the buses to make that happen. So, and the rest of it's over in the conversation with PAC.
Carol, this is a great plan, and I'm glad about the principles for 2016. But if this is in fact a template for next year, then you've got both a huge budget outlay and human capital and capacity issue with bringing on, I don't know how many, you'd be in the middle of March hiring 15 new principals next year this time?
We have a smaller, so part of what I'm doing, I'm going to show you, I'll run you through the DBRAC thing right after this if you want it. But it's also an overtime. Like, we're not doing, this is when there's no way we have the capacity to do a massive rollout and we all of a sudden are all middle schools. It's totally a 1, 2, yeah. Because you're doing not only the middle school, you're doing the K-5s.
Right.
You're doing the whole little feeder pattern. So there's a whole bunch of corresponding shifts and adjustments to make that all work. So we're trying to do the, okay, how do we do this kind of steady over time? And a bunch of the puzzle shifts as we're doing it, too, like we continue to grow and, anyway, so. And yes. Very right observation. And it's really complicated. And so. Other investments in our budget amendment, we added increased staffing and supervision for campus security agents. It was an add of 6 FTE that we did in the budget amendment. We're sustaining that going forward in the budget. So just people, I wanted to make that visible to people that we just did an add and we're holding on to it. And we added funding for security athletic events. We did an increase in the maintenance budget, just generally our ability to keep tending to facilities. They've been on a total bare bones, as you are all aware. So the degree to which we can keep adding that up is important. And then central support for interpretation services, so that it's not coming out of school budgets, but coming out of at least up to this dollar amount, we're going to try and supplement centrally interpretation. Sustaining the full week of outdoor school. We had health assistance in Madison Cluster last year that with our MESD dollars, rather than nurses infrequently, we did health assistance frequently, like every day, and people were really excited about that and really different for your school, your office staff and what they're having to deal with, and really good attention for kids and impacts attendance, and this was a high leverage one, so we're expanding that to Roosevelt, Jefferson, and Franklin clusters this year and sustaining it in Madison. If we have additional funds, then highlighting those ones I said at the beginning, that were the literacy and trying to accelerate how fast we're doing it, as well as really continuing to make sure we do that grade reconfiguration well.
and resource of compensation, what's happening with our groups, so PAT in negotiations, the rest are all already negotiated at 1.5 in COLAs, except at nutrition at 3% COLA, ECU 3% COLA. And our, over here on health insurance, actually, we've been trying to get comparable levels of health insurance that is paid by the district across all our employee groups. So that's something we've been trying to, we were frequently way high in for our teachers and low for everybody else. We're trying to do a glide path to get that all comparable across employee groups. School staff, we started on the 9th. You guys are my town hall, and we keep tinkering here. I go back with a proposal to the board on the 29th, then they are doing town halls and tinkering, and then that, which we try and do the, so the Community Budget Review Committee does a commentary and a report. The TSCC, Tax Commission, what is it, TAC, T, what's the S? Can't remember. TSCC is the tax commission, comes and does.
The S is supervisory, and I don't know what the second C is.
Anyway, every year before we pass the budget, they come and they interview us about the budget, and they do commentary, and then it goes for the adoption. And that's it. Okay. Available online if you want to read all the details. No. I glossed over, but that would be it. So stuff that you want to ask more about, not, otherwise I'll roll right in and do the debrief thing for you, unless you're already glazed over and done.
No.
Yeah. Literacy, the K through 5, you're saying there's going to be some target schools that have a full program. Do you know what schools those
I
are?
Do, but I don't bring all these lists. Do you know what those are?
So the 5 MHCRC schools are Lewis, Markham, and 3 others. and the other 5 haven't been identified yet. Because
yeah,
we've only just, it was only in the process of putting the budget together we could determine how far we could go. So they have, the grant schools, the schools who are involved in the grant know who they are. The other 5 have not been identified yet.
And it will be, like, it's 10 schools that will get the deep whole school thing this year. And which is frustrating. It'd be lovely if we could do the district wide all at once. Yeah, and it's 7.5 million.
And it's also
and capacity.
It's also 1,000 teachers. And so, you know, doing the professional development for every single school at once is daunting.
Yes.
What is the PPS cutoff for Title I for high schools? Is it 80?
Oh, God.
No, it's just changed.
Is 75?
It was 75 when we measured it by free and reduced meals. But we shifted to direct certification.
Oh.
It's more like 48.
Oh.
So
because
for high school.
Yes, because that criteria that's a different measurement, and so it the level is set differently. And
thank you very much.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, direct certification is a stricter test, and so the threshold is lower. But this year, next year, in 2016-17, we won't actually have any high schools that meet the threshold.
So
Roosevelt and Jefferson will be in a rich year. So they'll get Title I funding next year, but unless they go back up again, they will not get Title I funding the following year.
So I guess my question then, because the state has different thresholds than Portland Public Schools allocates, then where do we vision us moving our thresholds then for our districts? If we no longer have high schools that are meeting direct certification or, you know, Title I numbers, or free and reduced numbers,
like,
you know.
Would we move it?
Would we move it? Can we move it?
So that's 2 questions. Would we move it? Could we move it?
Right.
We can reset the threshold, but
right.
you get a set amount.
Yes.
You get a set amount of money regardless of where you put your threshold.
Right.
And the thing about moving it is we're getting less. We will get less Title I money as a district next year because our poverty levels district wide are going down relative to the rest of the state, and the state is getting less money because Oregon's poverty levels relative to the rest of the country are going down. And the issue with thresholds is if you bring the threshold down in order to include more schools, then everybody get, then you're spreading it thinner and people get less money.
And actually we did, the last time this conversation happened and the threshold moved, it was really trying to, I think, put priority on younger grades, getting more to be able to do the bolster that then benefits high schools because you've given the support at the younger grades by the, so it was like a philosophical,
right.
You know?
Yeah, we did, when we reset this,
Yeah.
10 years ago, back in the dark ages before Carol was superintendent. We had.
I was around. I was paying attention. Sorry.
We had. Yeah. We've always had a higher threshold for high school.
Right.
It looks confusing because the number changed when we shifted the measurement mechanism.
Right.
But the threshold is essentially the same as it was before. It's just that because we're measuring using a different measurement, the data point is different.
We had this conversation a little bit last year, same place. Chris Madison got dropped off the list last year.
Oh, yeah.
It was right on the line. What I was told at the time, and what is my understanding, was that, because I complained about Madison, was that what you said, the dollars weren't as well spent at high schools. And is that something that you're then?
It's more that you're going to either get a thin amount that goes to a lot of places, or you're going to get enough to do something with at a smaller number of places. And so, like, I think the thing was, okay, you're trying to bolster where you really are able to give the additional support.
Somebody from the district wrote me and told me that they actually didn't think that the funds were as impactful at high schools as they were in the lower grades, and I had no way to know what that really meant because I don't have kids in high schools. But
and everybody will tell you that losing any amount of resource is
bad.
Painful. Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
But you can see, I mean, you saw the slide. We're projected to be down almost $750,000 in Title I money next year. We're able to hold the per student allocation at the same level. In part because there are fewer kids. And then the following year, you know, and those five schools that I mentioned earlier will continue to receive Title I funding next year, but the following year they won't. And you know, that'll give us an opportunity. You know, it depends what happens to our funding. You know, if it keeps going down, we might still be able to keep the first student level up. I mean, it's a balancing act. When the resources are diminishing, it's a balancing act to figure out how you cope with that.
Erin, so can I just say, I'm Erin Barnett, I'm both district staff and I'm a repeat PTA member and former president. And just one thing that I know the superintendent was talking about with all hands raised and that all of you in this room feel good about and take back to your schools is that with Title I dollars dropping, we know there's still a lot of poverty. It becomes more hidden. The equity fund dollars that come from all of us who do hardcore parent fundraising and work so hard to raise money for our schools. Sometimes it's hard to tell our schools a third of it's going to go to this fund. Well, that fund is even more important now. And so feel really good about that. And that'll be coming out in another week, those grants, at a really important time for our district and our kids.
Go ahead.
So I appreciate that. I want to push back on that, though. I mean, as we increase, you know, school-based fundraising, we provide an out for state. You know, if we could all take half a day that we spent working on our auctions and run down to Salem and knock on some doors and yell at some people and bring the pictures of the children and say, the children. The equity fund, I mean, you know, I'm coming from a building who, you know, really dialed down on foundation raising, not because we didn't want to give money to an equity fund that had nothing to do with it. It's because we didn't want to participate in a system that we didn't feel was making it, a system that's no longer a Band-Aid interim system that had become institutionalized in our district. And I just really want to push back on the idea that this institutionalized kind of fundraising needs to bridge gaps for core services for our students. So.
And I appreciate the getting voices to Salem to get our core funding up because it's absolutely right. And what we always hear from legislators is hearing from, like, you guys,
way more powerful from hearing than hearing from like my guys. Like they want to hear from us, but they really want to hear from you. And tell them real stories and real impact. It's the most important thing. And they say, like, they hear this from other, like, health and human services. They get tons of people who show up.
Yeah.
Like, we show up, like, it's sporadically.
Yeah.
And we don't keep a narrative going all the time where people really get their heads around, like, what's the gap. And you'll have legislators believe, because they have done a huge amount of work to try and raise it. I mean, our whole conversation was like the what we used to call the quality education model doesn't even get us to average nationally,
right.
And we're like billions below it still.
Right, and
so
you
that's
have parents
cuckoo.
From this district go and speak to the committee.
That's what you need.
You know,
you guys have your most powerful voice with the legislature.
Yeah.
Yes.
So, and they were surprised that he came, I think, and they were surprised that he knew what he was talking about, I think, even more so. So, I mean, I think there's a big opportunity.
Totally there.
That's
totally right.
I think what she's saying is having the foundation system as a disincentive to be an advocate for the district.
We've got that conversation going on in a lot of schools across the district.
This
way. Where people were willing to do it in a certain, in a period of time, that when it was showing up and everybody was in crisis, and now it's just calling a different question. I think that you've got that conversation going on a lot of places. Yeah, Michelle.
Did you say to the amount that you had to invest was approximately $2.5 million this year? What was it last year?
It was significantly more than that.
More than
I mean, you saw the teacher, all the staff we added.
Yeah,
it was partly that was the impact of the change in legislation about local option, that it didn't get pulled off into urban renewal projects, but comes back to the districts. We had like a, and we had a couple
like
things.
17.
And then we had a couple things.
You know, it's amazing
how
much you forget in the space of 12 months. I actually don't remember what the number was, but it was
more than twice that, I think.
Oh, yeah.
And we had a bunch of things tilt in our direction in terms of tax collections, local option collection. We had a number of things tilt in our direction. And it was all directed to...
And the first year of the biennium, it's always, not always, but it's often better, because to the extent that the state raises, if they do actually raise funding, which they have done, not as much as they should do, but they've raised it some, then you get that bump in the first year of the biennium. In the second year, you're really just funded to hold steady.
So one thing I think, for me at least, would be useful, I like the pie charts, to look at that purchases were $6.5 million, and to see, and a large chunk was going to literacy, and a large chunk was going to DBRAC, but to see like what that, just that, what the extra money, how it's being invested. Because I think a lot of us would like this, like a think we see the maintenance part, which is.
So you want like kind of a pie chart like these, but about that six.
For just what you're doing with the what's left. And I thought it was really useful to see what reiterate what you were maintaining, because all those things are really important. But to try and get it, like, your list was very long of all the things that you want to do more this year, but just to get, like, how much of that is actually going into teachers?
So it's going into more support.
It seems like it didn't look
the
like
literacy,
it looked like a lot of support.
Yeah, we're not adding more teachers. We're doing, like, so we haven't done curriculum adoptions through a lot of this. We've siphoned it off to hold on to people, right? So the literacy adoption is a pent-up need of the $7.5 million that's like high urgency PD that we're preparing our people to be able to do. And we've had teachers involved in the process of preparing to do it, but the literacy adoption is tools for teachers. A bunch of the stuff you saw in the college and career readiness is all the supports for kids. And it's all school-based support kinds of things. And the enrollment balancing is how we convert to a different grade configuration and do it well. So we're not doing a hasty do it, but we don't give people the tools to do it. So we can articulate that in a picture. I like your idea of doing it graphically.
I think it would be helpful. And then one last thing, this is really maybe too, but I'm really bad at this. The permanent subs, where are those non-formula? So is that something like it's not going to be on there, and then we need to go and like bang on
good
the door?
Good question that I don't know the answer
to.
You know that? When we just added that pool of permanent subs or a couple of permanent subs for high need schools last year, I don't know if they showed up on their staffing tables or not.
No, because they're held centrally and then they're just allocated out as needed. So no individual school sees them because they don't. They're not locked in at a particular school.
So it's not in our staffing formula. They're just because they were allocated to specific schools.
I think they're at specific schools, like Scott just hired one recently.
Yeah. Right, I mean,
but it's not in their formula.
They're not permanently allocated to that school. They're let me put it this way. They're not intended to be permanently allocated.
There you go.
Okay, and then the other little side thing was that I just might, like, you added the middle school grade art programming last year, and so I'm sure it's a good thing, but it's not been long enough for this year to really know if it was enough. And I just,
Are you aware of someplace that's going away?
No, I don't know if it's going away. I think that I would think you might need more, that's all.
Oh, to add more.
I would be surprised if what you did last year was enough to have equitable art programming in the middle grade. So
we know it's not. I have a very long list of exactly those kind of things, of things that people want. When I say pendant need, we have a very long list of things people want more of. And part of the discipline of this budget is going to be, and board members have a list of projects they don't like to see happen, so here's the tension, is if you're doing priorities and you're trying to move those things, are you able to hang on to really investing those priorities, or do you say those are the priorities and then you come over and do everybody's favorite projects? So like the hard part about this budget is we have a really little amount of money. If we're really trying to make the priorities the board set move, we got to invest in making those happen. They're also going to come in and say, I want my gardens, I want my this, I want my favorite stuff. Like the stuff I care about is this. It doesn't have anything to do with the priorities. I want you to go do the priorities, Carol. I want the money over here to do this, right? So like that's exactly going to be all of our tension, is all the other stuff that is pent up that we want to be able to add that isn't about literacy and isn't about doing the enrollment balancing right. Go, Carol, yeah, we told you we want that. Go do that. And then, now we want this with the money. So anyway, that's
one of the importance of the enrollment balancing is to get the schools and the capacity right, so that you can
sustainable.
So you can get those programs.
Right, but that's going to take a while, like 5 years. So what I'm saying is, like, maybe we need to really make sure that the middle grade specifically.
And that is true.
And so I just pick art programming.
So here's what I would also say, is places where individual schools can't provide what we're considering core program, that's when they can come back and ask for the balancing FTE.
Which is great that you held more.
And we held more. So like places where you really feel like, okay, this is part of our core program and we are at risk of losing it, that's what they get to go ask for. So like that's the place at this point that it's kind of built in that you can preserve or try and hang on to capacity that isn't supported by student enrollment. So, and we need to grow more of it. Like in an ideal world, we wouldn't be feeling the loss of teams every time you have a tiny variability in kids. We'd be able to hold people steady. And we're not there yet. So, okay, yes.
Yeah, I heard your comment that you would like to see reserves go up to 5%.
We want them to go higher than that.
Okay.
Yeah.
Well,
3 is our policy, and we're still below policy now. We've had it at a 5, and our CBRC is really looking at trying to grow us a different threshold of reserve.
Well, so I really think that's because this is Oregon, and it does tend to have boom and bust. I think that's a great idea. I was wondering if what you would make the best case, like let's say that you do have a board that is looking at spending on not pet projects, but things they really like, and how do you, you know, go back and say, well, this is critical, like more than just saying, well, we have ups and downs. That's not really enough.
How do we say that the reserve is critical?
Yes.
So actually, I'm going to let Paul Anthony, who is chairs our business and operations, I'm just going to say, because this is one that's a real conversation for us, and we're in this whole trying to do this GFOA like financial model that has that starts to build a framework and budget policies and aspirations for what's a healthy organization. But Paul is the champion of that on the board level, so I'm going to let you respond.
And I think it's actually fairly easy to do. And David Wine can tell you how. we can come up with fairly reasonable projections for what the variation in the budget is liable to be in a downturn. We've seen them before, and we can project what the damage to the budget is liable to be over 2 or 3 years in a bad downturn. And then you just show how much you have to, how much of a cushion you have to have before you start having to lay off dozens and dozens and dozens of teachers. And that's, I think, a very compelling case for the board.
Thank you.
In spite of the desire to spend while we got it.
More stuff.
Yeah.
Thank you. Nicely done. And our citizen budget review group, I think this is also like being some of the citizen voice to support what Paul's saying. High
yes.
value. Yeah, that's high value for us.
And besides the CBRC, the audit committees also had the independent outside auditor doing a risk assessment of the district. And this is one of the issues that we brought to them. How much variability in funding do they see? They're a fairly large, fairly well-connected CPA firm. They've got a pretty good idea of what the variations in Oregon's budget are.
Okay, you guys, I'm aware that I'm now at my end of my time limit.
One last question.
I'll stay and do whatever you want. I'm just respecting your time with this.
I'm going to ask about the ELL kids. You said they were down 202 students, but you're not, the FTE is down, but you're adding.
We're preserving it for ELL services. So that was still the total that is extracted is reflected in those other, how are we deploying it?
And so are you seeing less ELL kids every year? Or are you keeping it? You're not reducing it because you expect to have more next year?
We're trying to hold, like, it's a group of students that we are needing to increase our level of support to serving them. So we're working, even though we're variation in kids, we're trying to hold the capacity to serve. But yeah, I don't know if you want to say more comments.
We are seeing less ELL kids. But in this upcoming budget, the idea is rather than just say, okay, less kids, less staff, we're holding the level of staffing constant
in
order to improve outcomes for kids.
So we don't want to have to keep take it down and then have to rebuild capacity. We're trying to hold steady the resource we've invested in having ELL capacity. So I think that's
and using
and
smart
deploying it in a smart way. Yeah.
Thank you very much for that.
Yeah.
So
yes.
I feel like I have to speak up on behalf of TAG kids because it doesn't show up particularly here. Mandated by state law to provide services for them. And if you ask any TAG parent in the district, if they're not at access, there's nothing for their kids. And it's certainly an equity issue. I mean, there are parents who can advocate and get stuff if they're really loud. But if they're not, or if the district, if that school sees the needs of the kids who are maybe not as successful and are focused entirely on that, or we're losing the top kids, they're dropping out of school, they're not graduating, higher suicide rates.
So the couple things I will say there is we're doing the compacted math was one of the issues actually
yes.
raised by TAG that we're trying to say this is an expectation that every school will have the capacity to offer it. So that's one.
Good.
Two, we're putting the emphasis on trying to get the advanced coursework consistent across the high schools and doing the calibration there and the who has access to it. So how are we really expanding and growing our capacity to offer advanced coursework? So I think
right.
that's the other one. Third one, we are looking for a home for access, which shows up in the DREC thing, which gives them some slight ability to expand. I believe it's not huge, but it's some slight ability to expand.
Well, and they're a tiny percentage of the TAG kids in the district.
And entirely, but just you mentioned access, so I'm just telling you that one. And then lastly, the TAG department they've built a plan for themselves that is essentially like us putting ourselves on a plan of assistance on TAG services. That is what they're doing right now to say we're doing a self-assign ourselves to be on, you know.
Yes, I was at that meeting last
yeah, exactly.
night.
So, and that they've done that. I mean, they're doing that.
But I guess, and one of the things that came out of that meeting, we had a lot of conversation with Andrew, that doing 4 or 5 schools a year does not get the 80 schools in the district met in any sort of reasonable fashion. And so we're pushing for a bigger ask and bigger movement to expand the scholar program to more schools more quickly.
Okay, good, good run to raise.
And the other thing is that the pre-K-5 adoption and instructional improvement.
Yes. It doesn't protect materials. And we called out that includes special ed tag, multilingual, and multicultural materials in every adoption. So, and that is, thank you for saying that one, David.
This is a little bit more of a kind of a maybe part of the background that might inform your budget. I'm curious. First of all, I'm very excited about the performance improvements that have happened in the last few years. The decrease in the achievement gap is incredible. What's happening in JEP is great. I'm a big fan of what's going on there. But I'm also curious, has the district done any analysis to try to evaluate how much of the progress we're making has to do with what we're doing in buildings and in programs, and how much of it has to do with demographic changes in the community and our most vulnerable populations getting pushed east? And if that's part of it, I presume it is some, I don't mean to be cynical, but I presume it is some, does that then inform our budget decisions in terms of where we're making investments in terms of trying to impact equity?
It's a good question. I don't know that I don't right at this moment have a full-blown analysis for you, because I will say there are bunches of factors in here, and it's about, like Jefferson, I would also say, some of the stuff we did in high school system design, which people probably, nobody else remembers this. I do, because I have all the bruises all over me from having done this. But having trying to get like schools that could be a healthy size and offer program after we came out of No Child Left Behind, where we were trying to get everyone to some kind of a size that you could be healthy as a community school. And then Jefferson, by making them a focus option, we took them out from under the closure hammer. Because they could offer program in relation to PCC. But we put something in place that we then have sustained over 5 years. Like, that's unheard of for Jefferson. We've had strong leadership. No, I'm serious. Strong leadership. We whittled down to say, these are the 3 partners. We're not distracting you with every partner who comes and wants to offer you something. Focus on these 3. Focus on what the kids need, and we will support you. And I mean, I'm going to say I believe that's a part. And they've had steady growth, achievement growth. They've had steady graduation growth, and they've had steady enrollment growth. So, like, over this entire period of time of doing it, and are all of our other schools that were on the downward spiral with No Child Left Behind have done the turnarounds and started to increase. But again, it's then having steady school staff, steady leadership, steady school staff, enough kids to offer a core program. We're working on not, we've added significantly supports and teachers at the high school. The 8-period day has been a huge thing in terms of kids being able to take more than just remedial things if they need it. They have an opportunity to take the supports they need, but also take electives and things that interest them. So I think there have been a bunch of factors that have been part of this. And we get the demographic shift as a factor for us as well. So I don't know how much that plays a role in terms of changing, but I have a bunch of things that we've been very intentional about that I think are having an impact. So,
and our disaggregated numbers are improving as well. So
Yes, our African American students at Jefferson, 81% graduation rate. So, I mean, that's significant. That's it. Like that. Yeah. Rocks. That rocks. So,
Did I miss on the thing? For DLI.
Specifically for DLI,
yeah.
There's not something else that's called out. We're sustaining the level of DLI that we currently have. So there's
for
not
those of us who are acronym.
A dual language version.
Okay,
dual language learning. Yeah, so there was not like a significant, we have done some significant growth in previous years. We're expanding the next grade levels in schools that have it. And I'll say our big challenge with DLI right now, as you know, is the staff. Substitutes. Yeah, exactly.
So I have a question to build on the earlier comments about the state actually meeting its responsibility and paying for the services. And I know that at the state level, first of all, Oregon PTA is supportive of a revenue plan that we think is going to bring that revenue. What would you invest in? Because COSA, the Federation of School Board Administrators, is going around the state now to have thousands, we hope, of discussions about what would those schools look like if we could make those investments. Do you have your top five list of things that you would pour more resources into? Because I would like to leave on a positive, you know, yeah. Let's go raise the revenue, let's go invest in schools and plan for the future.
Well, and we are going to participate in those Oregon Rising right. conversations, which is right. about envisioning. And I think a bunch of this is about giving, like, I think they've been named in this room in terms of where are the places right. that we've got this much of something that we have this much of, and it is about having full arts programs, doing the arts articulation through the entire cluster, doing our TAG programs, so you really have a there in every single school. It's having curriculum material for teachers to work with, and our ability to roll out an adoption in one move rather than having to sequence it over multiple years, way more complicated to do over multiple years because we only have a small, I mean, there become huge things. The enrollment balancing thing, if we're really able to open middle schools that are fully staffed and fully programmed with support services and enrichments, oh my goodness, people would be like over the moon. I mean, we just have numbers of things that we've got teed up.
If you want five things, working from the least important of the five to the most important of the five, we have custodians in our buildings at national average, national standard levels. We'd have a maintenance budget where we could actually take care of our buildings and do preventative maintenance and not wait for a 30-year capital program. We'd have a budget for curriculum materials and the associated professional development and the other tools that you needed, which would be a permanent budget item, putting us back on a seven-year replenishment cycle. And for us, that's about $7.5 million a year. And we're scraping to try and find $3 million next year. And then we'd have support, robust supports for kids.
Okay.
And the most important is we'd have staffing for full programs. There's your five things.
And we wouldn't have the enrollment, like if you have enrollment fluctuations, you'd be able to keep your core staff and keep your team together. So you're not like,
And we would share the vision that parents, as the prodigious fundraisers that we are, would raise for the extras. Yeah, and not for the core.
Right. Absolutely. You raise for the things that make your school unique, yeah. and the core is taken care of
for by
the district, the state, and the district. Yes, yeah. I totally agree. Okay, guys, I'm going to just tell you, I'm sorry you're not going to get your scenario, but it's online, so it's available. Thank you.
Every other day she gets spit on, but today she gets a lot more.
Thank you.
And that is
her
meeting.